Shadilay, my dudes, and welcome to the Oversimplified Lore Series, the series where I will explain video game lore quickly and efficiently. Too efficiently. The Elder Scrolls games are a fantastic series of sandbox RPG games that many of us enjoy very much. However, some are not completely satisfied with just the gameplay of these games. Many Elder Scrolls fans seek to learn more about the world around them and how it came to be. Throughout the Elder Scrolls games, many races have different beliefs about how the world of the Elder Scrolls began. However, most have vast consistencies with each other, so a broad picture of the lore can be drawn with the information we currently have. The first period of time is known as the Dawn Era, and we shall cover everything about it today. Keep in mind that this is my personal interpretation of Elder Scrolls lore, and my take can be very different than someone else's depending on the source in which the lore was gathered from. Without further ado, let's get to it. Here we go! In the beginning, there was only the Void and Anu, the Everything. Anu is a primordial force which embodies stasis and light. Anu eventually encountered Padme, a wild force which embodies chaos and change. It is important to note that these two beings should be seen as primordial forces rather than intelligent entities. They just are. They do not plot or think or have an existence fathomable by mere mortals. The two met in the Void, and within this meeting, the divine interplay is known as the Arbis. Within the Arbis, things are rapidly changing from stasis to chaos and back to stasis and so on. From this point on, things within the Arbis would begin to shape the Elder Scrolls universe as we know. First, Anu birthed a soul named Anu-El, which is the soul of all things. It is said that Anu birthed this soul in order to understand and comprehend itself. Likewise, Padme would also birth a soul named Sithis, who embodies the limitations of all things. Between the interplay of Anu-El and Sithis, darkness and light were separated in order to form Oblivion and Aetherius, respectively, with Oblivion representing the limitation of Aetherius. The next phase in the Dawn Era sees Anu-El, just like Anu birthed him, birthing a soul known as Akka or Akatusk in the Nordic tongue, and also Sithis birthing a being known as Lorcan. Each one would come to embody time and space respectively. Here is where Elder Scrolls lore gets complicated. Akka or Akatusk may be unknown to some or most of you. It is very important to realize that he is not Ariel, he is not Akatosh, and he is not Alduin. Rather, he is the original being of which all the time gods in the Elder Scrolls universe were shattered from. And we'll get into that in a little bit, but for now, it's important to understand that Ariel, Akatosh, Alduin, and so on are actually shards of Akka. Much like a piece of glass shatters into many numerous shards of itself, big and small, so too did Akka shatter into many numerous shards. For the big three, Ariel embodies what would be known as the beginning of time. In a similar way, Akatosh embodies the present time, or the body of time. And lastly, Alduin embodies the end of time, after which time resets itself back to the beginning and Ariel is present again. This cycle of linear time would be known as a kalpa. Getting back to the Dawn Era, Anu-El and Sithis did not stop at Akka and Lorcan. They each birthed many spirits into the sphere of Oblivion. These original spirits are known as the Et-Ada. The Et-Ada at this time did not have a very good sense of purpose, and the Arbis was chaotic, so Akka created a concept known as time, which helped to stabilize the current situation in the Arbis. This creation of time is what is suspected to have shattered Akka into many time gods I talked about earlier. Being the shard of time which embodies the beginning, Ariel is now present in the Arbis as a separate entity. After the Arbis was stabilized and the Et-Ada became less chaotic, Lorcan devised a plan to create the ultimate paradise in which the Et-Ada could live and prosper. This paradise would be known as Mundus, and he would need the help of the other Et-Ada in order to make his wish a reality. One such Et-Ada who would aid Lorcan in the creation of Mundus is Magnus. Magnus was a greater Et-Ada, and he became the architect of Mundus. Lorcan managed to convince other Et-Ada to partake in his plan for Mundus and give of themselves for the mortal plane. This would be known as the Convention. Of the Et-Ada who completely gave of themselves to Nirm, the ones who would become its laws and aspects of nature would be known as the Earthbones or Elnafe. The ones who became the laws of nature can still appear, but usually only through specific summoning. The first Elnafe was known as Ifri, and he is still worshipped by the Bosmer today. We'll talk about the Elnafe later. Those who gave to Nirn and retained their divinity became the eight planets which surrounded Nirn and are known as the Eight Divines and the Aedra, which means our ancestors in the Elven tongue. Magnus, after realizing what the creation of the mortal plane was doing to the Et-Ada, convinced as many Et-Ada he could to flee Mundus while it was still unstable. These Et-Ada would be known as the Magna Gi. They tore holes through Oblivion to Aetherius, creating the stars. Magnus tore a much bigger hole than the rest of the Magna Gi, and this would be known as the Sun. The holes to Aetherius would flood Magicka into Mundus, stabilizing it and leaving the divine spirits trapped. It is assumed that this too was a part of Lorcan's plan, and this marks the end of the creation of Mundus and the beginning of war. First though, before the war, let's talk about the Elnafe. As mentioned before, the Elnafae are those spirits who lost their mortality but still kept their divine power, or at least some of it. There are two types of Elnafae. Those who spread out across Nirn far and wide were known as the Wandering Elnafae. Those who saw the coming doom of the draining of their mortality and pulled their power together and therefore retained most of their power were known as the Old Elnafae. They settled in the land of Aldmeris. The Wandering Elnafae stumbled across the land of Aldmeris and encountered their old brethren. At first, they were excited to finally meet their vastly more powerful brethren, but the old Elnafae saw them as low and not worth their respect, something to be pitied. This started the first types of racism among the races of Nirn. At some point after this encounter, Ariel descended onto Nirn to the old Elnafae in order to teach them how to manipulate the land to their liking. At about the same time, Lorkhan descended to the Wandering Elnafae along with Kind to mold the first races of men, but not Redguards. Redguards are a different story altogether. Ariel and the old Elnafae, after seeing that Lorkhan had returned, he who bound them to Mundus and a life of mortality, struck across the land of Tamriel along with the others who sided with Ariel. Lorkhan struck back in retaliation with his new race of men, and so began a War of the Divine. The war saw men conquer then Altmora, known today as Atmora, which they would keep until the late Morethic era. Ariel brought with him three notable supporters which would decimate the battlefield: Finaster, Cerebane, and Trinimac. The last of these three, Trinimac, ended the war by striking down Lorkhan on the field of battle, tearing Lorkhan's heart out of his chest. The remains of Lorkhan's body were cast from Nirn and became the Two Moons Master and Secunda. The Divines then met in Adamantine Tower, known today as the Dorini Tower. There, the supporters of Ariel met to destroy the heart of Lorkhan. This point in time was known as the Moment of Convention. When they tried to destroy it, the heart laughed at them. Ariel then tied the heart to an arrow and shot it into the sea east of present-day Morrowind. The heart would further defy Ariel and create present-day Vardenfell along with Red Mountain. After this, Ariel met with the old Elnafae who supported him, known as the Children of Ariel, and ascended in their presence to show them that there was a way to rise to godhood once again. However, they never did ascend like their god, and their power diminished with each passing generation. They eventually devolved into the Aldmer and settled in the Somerset Isles while their home of Aldmeris disappeared. The Wandering Elnafae, who were not molded into men, took on form based on their surroundings. They became all the creatures and plant life of Nirn and had greatly diminished power and lifespans with each successive generation. The start of Elven recording of history ends the Dawn Era and begins the Morethic Era. Well, my dudes, that is the Dawn Era. I hope you all enjoyed the video. Make sure you hit that subscribe button and comment, or get court-martialed. Re indeed, and stay frosty, my dudes.